each other to try to put Islam down. Islam is still the fastest in United States and in Mexico. I have access to some of this firsthand because I travel those countries and I visit them, and alhamdulillah, I personally have witnessed many thousand people entering into Islam, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. In addition to that, there's another statistic that, according to Madeleine Albright, back at the time of the Clinton administration, when President William Clinton was in office, and that during the time of Ramadan, she said that one in four people on earth is a Muslim. According to our statistics, it's one in five, but I hope she's right. Bill Clinton said that Islam is the fastest growing religion, he said. In 2001, George W. Bush, the second Bush in presidency, said that Islam is a peaceful religion. These are statistics that you can verify yourself from the newspapers. But I'd like to mention a statistic that you hardly ever hear anything about, even from Muslims, because it's not really that much, it's not that well known, nor is it published. However, I think it's quite interesting. I think it's a phenomenon that probably is worthy, at least, maybe not a book, but at least an article. And that's the subject of religious leaders of other religions who vacate their office, leave their jobs, and switch from their religion to Islam. Because when a person changes from one religion to another, it could be for a number of reasons. For marriage, social position, to get better employment. You can understand some of these reasons. But when the leader of a religion changes to another religion, you have to ask yourself a serious question. What does he know that the other people don't know? What would attract him to such a thing? Now, according to the teachings of the psychiatrists, psychologists, those so-called mental scientists, which, by the way, are not in disagreement in this case with Islam, that the human being is really only motivated by two factors: the hope of a reward or the fear of a loss. People do something hoping to get something, or they are trying to stop something bad from happening to them. Well, this makes sense. So what would it be that this religious leader sees as a gain for himself by leaving his position, by walking out on his flock or his congregation? What would it be that he would fear that would cause him to turn his back against what he grew up in, what he studied in, what he holds his PhD in or his degree? Certainly his notoriety or his fame or whatever he might have, that it would be very strange for a person to leave their religion. And I'll give you a case in point to think about. Recently, in the United States, a number of clergy from the Catholic religion were accused of a very heinous crime. A large number, in the hundreds and hundreds, were accused, and we won't go into whether or not they're guilty, but they were accused of having sexual relations with boys. They were accused of this. And as I said, we're not going to get into whether or not they're guilty, but certainly we can see this would be an opportunity for them to go to some other religion. But then on the other hand, what religion would accept people that do such as this? And there was no migration of any of these priests or bishops who left their religion because of this reason. They stayed in their religion. It happened in 2001 on the 4th day of July, and it wasn't being celebrated as 4th of July because I was in Cairo, Egypt. They don't celebrate 4th of July over there. But it happened on that day, on the front page of the newspaper, they were mentioning that the government had taken away the license from a newspaper to print newspapers anymore. They can't be in the newspaper business because that newspaper was guilty of putting pictures of a priest on the front page, second page, and third page, because all these pictures were pictures of the priest with a woman, different women. He was with her with no clothes and doing so and so, and it came that these pictures had been taken by the priest himself. He was blackmailing them to get money from them after he would do this thing with them. And it was movies that he was making. And somehow he got caught, and they published it on the news. Well, of course, you know, instead of punishing him, they punished the newspaper for reporting it. I wish they would do that over here. Punish the newspapers for what they report. Who wouldn't have any newspapers? Who wouldn't have anything to put in the bottom of the birdcage, would we? Anyway, I'm mentioning this because I thought about it and I said, you know what? That priest got in big trouble, right? I mean, if it happened over here, my God, they might, don't know what they would do. All they did to that man, by the way, they just moved him to another parish. They moved him to another area and he was still in business. But the newspaper's not. Why didn't he go to another religion? Why didn't he go to Islam? Why didn't those priests of the Catholic Church go to Islam? Why didn't the bishops, why didn't those other people who got in trouble, why didn't they leave their religion and go to Islam? I mean, after all, if that's why people would leave, that would be a good chance. And we do know that people from the leadership of both of these religions have gone to Islam, but they weren't being accused of anything. In fact, they were being hailed by their people and their congregation as being some of the best of their leaders, of course, until they went to Islam, and then they were the worst of the worst. Is this the first time such a thing has ever happened? Is this a new phenomenon? And actually, if you study in the biography of the Sirah of Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, if you look to the biography of Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, you will find that very same thing was happening during his time. There was a person by the name of Abdullah bin Salam, and he was one of the best of the scholars of the Jewish religion in Medina at the time of the messengership of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, 1400 years ago. And when he spoke to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked questions, he came to understand that in fact this is the very prophet we've been talking about, thinking about and praying for and so, this is him. He knew, he understood. He said, but before I do anything, I want you, you know, before I talk to my tribe and show them that I agree with this message, I want you to ask them who I am. Ask them, ask about me. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went in front of the tribe of these Jewish people there, the Arabs, and he asked them about Abdullah bin Salam. They said, well, he is, I swear, he is the most knowledgeable of religion of us, and the son of the most knowledgeable of us, and he is the best of us, and he is the son of the best of us. More or less the translation. And so it was asked to them, well, what would you say if he went to the religion of Muhammad? What if he decided he wanted to do that? They said, may Allah save him from this. A'udhu billah. And he stepped forward in front of them suddenly, and he appeared in front of them and he told them, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He said, I bear witness there's none worthy to worship except the one true God, Allah. And I bear witness Muhammad is the messenger. And the people turned and they said, he is the worst of knowledge of us and the son of the worst of the knowledge of us, and he is the worst from among us and the worst of the son of the worst of us. All of it. You know, they're away from him immediately. How could people change their minds so quick? We'd like to also mention before we get to our story, a Christian who at that time, and there were several famous Christians at that time, scholars of their religion, such as Adi bin Hatim, and also Salman al-Farsi. And these people had actually, Salman al-Farsi had traveled from scholar of Christianity to scholar and lived with them until they died. And they would always send him to somebody else before they passed away until the last one sent him straight to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "We heard about the Prophet in the desert, you need to go check it out." Something like this, more or less. And he did, and he heard what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what he responded to the questions, and he said, "There's no doubt this is the Prophet of Allah that was promised in the scripture." And by the way, while I'm mentioning it, even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he first got the message, he got the calling or the initial words of the Quran, which came to him in Jabal Nur, the mountain of light, when Jibril, Gabriel, the angel, came to him and told him, "Ikra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq." When this came, he went to his wife, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he went to his wife, Khadija, and he told her, "Cover me up." And she said, "What's going on?" He said, "Just cover me up." And she covered him. And he was acting sort of strange, you know, because of this amazing thing which just happened. When she came to understand what was going on, she was the first to say, "I accept this message. You must be the messenger of Allah." And she bears witness to La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. None worthy to worship except Allah, Almighty God alone, and Muhammad the messenger of God. And then she, Khadija, his wife, took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace be upon him, to her uncle Waqara. And when they went to the uncle was old. Probably, according to one I read, it said like maybe 90. He was an elderly man. And he was one who had translation of the Bible to the Arabic language. And this, he was saying, is the scripture mentioning that, in fact, this is the one, that Muhammad, he is the one. He said, "I wish I would live long enough to see the time when your own people are going to cast you out, going to throw you out." And it happened exactly what he said. Just like he said it was going to happen. How would he know except that he had the scripture right there saying what was going to happen? So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was believed by Waqara to be the messenger of God, and that God is one and he has no partners. It was believed by Abdullah bin Salam, Adi bin Hatim, and also by Salman al-Farsi to be the messenger of God, and the message is La ilaha illallah, none worthy to worship except Allah. On and on until today. Until this day when we're sitting here now, and I'm still getting emails from people who say, "You know, I used to be a priest. I was a preacher." A woman said, "I was a nun." She came up to me in California, "I was a nun, and now alhamdulillah I came to Islam." My own personal experiences have shown me that many of the religious leaders, those who are trying to get the closest to God, come over in the most beautiful way, across a beautiful bridge. A bridge of hidayah or guidance that brings them from this path of trying to get to Allah through Christianity and coming straight on over to the message of La ilaha illallah. Many people ask me, "How did you come to Islam?" And so today, inshallah, I will try to give you a brief, just a brief introduction to that subject, and may Allah guide me to say the words that are pleasing to Him, and may He prevent me from saying things which will misguide me. And it comes about something like this. It was in the early part of 1991 that my father, who was an ordained minister, but also a businessman, came to me in his house one time and he said to me, "You know what? I'm starting to do business and we're going to be doing business with a man. He's from Egypt." And I said, "Well, that's a good idea. You know, that sounds fantastic." He said, "Yeah, we're going to be bringing some import stuff. We're going to do so and so." I said, "This is a good idea." I'm thinking, you know, pyramids, Sphinx, Nile River, Cleopatra, or whatever that's worth. My father said, "Oh, yeah, and he's a Muslim." I said, "A what?" "Oh, no way, Dad. This doesn't work." Because from our preacher friends, we had heard a lot of things against the Muslim religion. And nowadays, they don't even believe in God. And I reminded him, I said, you know, they're terrorists, they're hijackers.